Good morning, one and all present. On behalf of the Department of Civil Engineering, Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering, I welcome you all for the seminar on energy conservation and automation in buildings. We have arranged three experts to enlighten us on this topic. These lectures are being organized under the banner of IGBC student chapter of our institute. The Indian Green Building Council was formed as a part of the Confederation of Indian Industry. The vision of the council is to enable a sustainable built environment for all and facilitate India to be one of the global leaders in the sustainable built environment. Our first session is by Dr. Rajasekhar Ilangovan, Associate Professor, Department of Architecture and Planning, Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, on the topic Energy Demand Reduction in Residences, the Challenges in the Indian Context. I welcome you, sir. Thank you very much for accepting the invitation and joining with us today. We shall start the session. So I'll just briefly introduce our speaker to you all. Professor E. Rajasekhar is an associate professor at IIT Roorkee in the Department of Architecture and Planning and joint faculty at the Center for Transportation Systems. He is an architect specialized in functional efficiency of built environments and building physics. He holds an MS by research and PhD degree from Building Technology and Construction Management Division, Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Madras. Prior to joining IIT Roorkee, he has worked at the Center for Excellence and Futuristic Developments, Building and Factories, L&T Construction as a research and development engineer for 5 years. His research is focused on methods and materials to achieve climate-sensitive, environmentally responsive, and digitally knit-built environments. He is currently researching in the areas of thermal comfort and energy efficiency in built environments, building information modeling, and energy information systems. He has received over $1 million grants for research in this field from various national and international agencies and industries. He has been awarded IUSSTF Bhavan Postdoctoral Fellowship and Shastri Indo-Canadian Doctoral Fellowship. He has authored over 50 publications in leading international journals and peer-reviewed international conferences. He has been associated with the green and energy efficiency rating of several commercial buildings across India. He has provided acoustical design and noise control solutions for various projects. And all of us are aware of and are doing a lot of certification courses in NPTEL or SWIAM platform. He has also handled classes there on principles and applications of building science and glass processing technology. And sir, I have to tell, I have also, I'm going through your lectures on architectural acoustics for my classes also. I welcome you once again, sir. You may now please take over the session.
Thank you. Thank you for arranging this session and the series of lectures and discussions. I am really glad that at the engineering level, at the undergraduate level, the student team is going to be highly enlightened with several perspectives. I wouldn't say a lot of learning, it might as well happen, but I wouldn't take that as a first benefit of this, but rather you are getting to meet a lot of people from the field, from different institutions. I think that's a wonderful thing that the team is doing. And thanks for reaching out to me. It's my pleasure to talk to you on this occasion. So without taking much of the time, I would just start quickly with the topic that I'm here to talk about. We all understand energy demand as one of the crucial aspects of our building. We are considering it very crucial because that is something we pay for. The more energy we spend, the more power we consume, the higher is the bills that we are paying. But as such, we have, you would have seen in the literature that the energy demand has drastically increased in the last couple of decades, and it is projected to grow by 2 or 3x times in the next couple of decades, at least by 2030 it is projected so. But there are certain specific Indianized or India specific challenges which are lying ahead, when we talk about energy demand prediction, analysis, or reduction in the built environment. I have particularly shown interest to talk on residences because that is the most diverse building in which, energy consumption as well as energy efficiency is very crucial to work on. I'm not saying commercial building is easy, but it is more or less uniform. You have a IT office, it runs with a certain type of, there is a centralized operation of that building. So the building is done well, good technology is placed, well operated. I think you can nearly guarantee certain amount of energy saving. Whereas residences are not like that because you handle it in your own way. So in that sense, understanding energy, energy use as well as energy efficiency in residences is one of the very crucial thing, though it is the most simplest form of building, that as engineers, each one of you would at least be part of a few residences in their design, construction, or so on. When we talk about energy demand reduction, its primary requirement is to understand what is the basis of the energy that we are talking about. Say, India, as you know, currently looks at five different climate zones. We have, Chennai and a large swath of coastal areas lying in a warm and humid region, or rather classified as a warm and humid region. Next is a composite, which is occupying nearly one third of the country. Then you have arid or hot and dry, cold regions on the north, and some hill areas in the southern area, southern part. And a little bit of temperate or moderate climates like Bangalore, Mysore, these areas are classified. What Bureau of Energy Efficiency is doing currently is it has a star rating plan. That is, it gives you stars like you would find in your appliances. When you buy an air conditioner, you buy a 3-star, 5-star rated air conditioner. Likewise, they have a star rating program for buildings. And in case of residences, they define the energy in terms of EPI, that is Energy Performance Index. It is nothing but your annual energy consumption as a factor of the floor area, or normalized with your floor area. It is kilowatt hours per meter square per year. So when let us say, we are talking about 55 to 67 as an EPI, we are talking about 55 kilowatt hour or 55 units per square meter per year. So the lesser you consume, the more stars you are eligible to get. So this is the way the star rating program has been defined. And it's one of the fine initiatives for at least earmarking and understanding how buildings consume energy, especially residences. I would come back to this map a few times in due course of this presentation, because primarily we are not going to lecture or, discuss about what is energy, what is energy efficiency. That's not the intent, but rather we are trying to understand what are the challenges, why we are not still able to mainstream. Like some countries clearly have a mark saying if you have this much energy performance or energy efficiency, only then your building is good to operate. Like in civil, you have the structural drawings and its approval. Only when the structural system is approved, you can construct the building. But nothing such exists for energy or sustainable aspects of the building. It's a voluntary thing as on date. So we will come back to that. For a moment, if we have to understand energy demand in buildings, we need to understand this Venn diagram. Basically, there are three aspects which I have tried bringing together. First, there is an environment, that is where exactly you are building the structure. Let us say you have a two-bedroomed residential unit. Where is this located? Is it in Chennai? Is it in Delhi, Roorkee? So depending on its environment, there is a natural thermal load or a climate load which is present on you as well as your building. So naturally, there is a mandate of consuming certain amount of energy. Say you are settling in a very moderate or like a temperate region. Naturally, your energy intensity or energy demand is going to be lower compared to when you really want to settle down in a very harsh environment, be it very hot, very cold conditions, you are prone to be consuming higher energy. This is very natural and by virtue of the climate. Number two, we have people. What type of people we are? In the sense, what do we really require? In terms of comfort, in terms of luxury, there is a thin line between, you know, need as well as luxury. What do we need versus what do we really feel as, you know, or take pride as owning something. You know, you would want to own a slightly bigger car than you can really afford to. You would, you know, probably get used to a way of living, though it is not very sustainable, but eventually you end up with your, you know, energy profile in that manner. So it is driven by occupant. And third, it is the building that we live in. Whether the building is climate responsive, whether it is designed like that, whether it is intended, you know, to give you certain efficiencies, etc. But interestingly, these three are not totally independent of each other. To an extent, both our theoretical knowledge as well as some of our country's code implementations have taken into consideration the interaction effects of building and the environment. Usually, like the last map I showed you, when I say there is a star rating, the star rating is for a specific climate zone. A warm and humid region has certain range of star, you know, EPI values prescribed. You look at National Building Code, you look at SP 41, you have certain performance attributes defined for each climate zone. So we have building corresponding to the environment. To an extent, it is taken care. The interaction gives you the term climate responsive design. Then, of late, we have had an understanding of the interaction between environment and the occupant. This has not been very well understood in Indian context, at least. But eventually, in the last at least decade, we have had an increasing realization that occupants are not totally independent. We also have certain close connect to the climate or the environment we live in. Say, for instance, I moved to Roorkee about 6 years back from Chennai. Chennai has a very good sultry environment. I prefer that sultriness, whereas if you look at summers in Roorkee, it is very hot, but it is pretty dry. The relative humidities are 20% or around that, sometimes lesser. Whereas you would get the same temperature in Chennai, maybe 43 degrees, but the humidity is 80% or so. One may feel so suffocated, but moving to Roorkee, I found this as literally not too, you know, tolerable. This dry heat is something my, you know, system really didn't take. There is a very close relation between where I have been living, what I have been adapting to, versus where I have moved. It is 6 years, 6 summers I have moved on, but still I am finding it difficult to cope up with. Similarly, the winters here, they are not very critical winters. You get about 4 degrees, 3 degrees minimum temperature, but that is like way too much because I am used to wearing sweaters at 24 degrees in Chennai. So this is a drastic difference. So how does it affect the building's energy demand? I end up using more air conditioning system than a typical person, you know, born and brought up or living for a longer duration in Roorkee would actually be using. I end up using a lot of heating system for a longer duration. So if you look at my electricity bills for the heating season, cooling season, they will be at least twice than a native person in this region. It's probably not a person's fault altogether. You can be as conscious as you can, but it is your body plus your psychology getting used to a particular environment. This is, to an extent, you know, brought down in the standards. It is being put in black and white in the terms of adaptation and thermal preferences. The recent, or rather the last version of National Building Code also mentions about certain amount of adaptation, but this is a very highly subjective aspect. So it is not that easy to put it down as a simple equation in a paper. The last part, that is the interaction between occupant and building, is something which we have, in my view, really not understood. The simple example, say I am staying in a residence today and tomorrow you are going to occupy that residence, the energy demand is considerably going to vary. And this is true with, you know, the studies we have been conducting for the last about 10 years. This is one of the significant learnings that we have had, saying it is about to do with the person, his attribute versus what the building is. Right? So these two things together gives you something called a probability associated behavior. So far, if you look at energy consumption, energy demand, this is looked at as a deterministic factor. We always say, if you have, you know, 60 kilowatt hour per meter square per year, then you have certain rating for your building. Whereas it depends on who is going to live. I'm going to share some of the cases that we have found some interesting things, facts. But the part is, it's at least, you know, plus or minus 30 to 35%. You know, there is plus or minus one third minimum, I'm saying, variation possible, depending on who stays or who owns the place. The same air conditioner, your operating versus my operational conditions would lead to different energy profiles or energy, you know, consumption profiles, ultimately leading to a drastic difference in the overall energy performance. So if you look at, there are a few key issues which any researcher or any implementation agency would come through. One is the weather dynamics, dynamics associated with the weather. We have been doing some studies on the last 30 years of weather data. We have, you know, kind of undertaken few research works in this field for selected cities across the country, where we look at the past 30 years of weather data continuously and the buildings operating over 30-year duration. So we are able to see something very interesting in terms of the energy consumption and its variation over a period of time. What we call as energy efficiency today would have been totally, you know, not making sense 20 years back as well as at least 10 years from now. So the contexts are completely different. Plus, if you look at the long-term phenomena, let us say the climate dynamics, we are talking about climate change and its impact. In one of the studies recently when we did, you know, for a office space in Delhi, it's a small or rather medium of scale office building in Delhi. You know, we were looking at what is the projected energy demand over the next 30 to 40 year duration approximately. What we found was, to an extent, the heating energy demand was going down because the winters are slightly getting warmer. Summers, there was not much change. But the crucial thing was happening in the moderate seasons. Anyone who is, you know, from this region, maybe any of these belt, you know, UP, Madhya Pradesh, Haryana, this area, composite region, would actually be able to appreciate, say, we used to have a good set of spring and, you know, fall seasons. The fall season typically from, you know, mid or late September all the way up to November end or something like that, before the peak winter sets in. Similarly, from end February or towards from the beginning of Holi all the way up to, you know, late April or something. Couple of months we used to have a pleasant season where you wouldn't even need a fan. But the study from Delhi showed us that this season has really shrunk. This season is being eaten away by a little bit of colder as well as warmer periods, which ultimately means the energy demand is going to be higher even in this season, which otherwise was not really requiring any major, you know, power to run appliances, at least for space conditioning purposes. Then there is a second point which is relating to the mean versus peak demand. This is a very interesting problem that we are also working on through international research, where we are always talking about mean energy demand. When I said energy performance index, it talks about X kilowatt hours per meter square per year. So we are talking about the total divided by, you know, something. So we are normalizing it. But what happens when everybody is starting to consume power at the same time? You would have seen in your residences, especially, you know, Chennai, it's a very common phenomena. If you try running your air conditioner between 8 to 10 in the night, it struggles. Unless you are using an inverter air conditioner, the normal window or split AC, especially window air conditioners, the compressor would be struggling to run. In older days, you know, the fluorescent lights, the T5 lamps would struggle to glow. The voltage is dropped and there is not much power to run the appliances. This is a problem of peak demand, where everybody is wanting power at the same time. The grid is really stressed. So predicting the peak demand is another key issue, which is totally dynamic in nature. We are not going to talk too much about that in this session, at least. As we said, there is a lot of operational dynamics in the building depending on people. Then interestingly, since you know we are talking as a part of IGBC chapter, any green building or any sustainable venture doesn't have a definitive path. I can achieve energy efficiency by 100 different methods. And each of them would actually lead to a different type of energy signature. I mean, this is a very frank truth. I may have certain shortcuts to achieve energy efficiency, which doesn't cost me too much, but still I can prove on record that this is going to be energy efficient. Whereas there are certain cost intensive ventures which could be little, you know, leading to a nearly similar outcome, but in the long run it could be fruitful. But both of them will nearly give you a similar rating, similar type of energy saving, etc. I'm not saying costly solutions are better, but there are, you know, there is a kind of tie between where you invest, what you get. There is an investment return which goes into the place. Even see, if I have to buy a new air conditioner, if somebody says this is 10,000 more, I think there is a very less likelihood that I would buy that gadget. There is a lot of cost benefit trade-off which every customer, every owner, every, you know, builder, every operator has in terms of investing and achieving energy efficiency. As we talk about this, in theory, when you take a course, when you understand the subject, we start understanding parameters very linearly, you know, in a very series mode. You know, we say series connection, connected in series. We start understanding sun, earth, you know, parameters one by one. We slowly move into the building and ultimately we learn about the cost. But in reality, this is what actually happens. Every parameter is connected to the other parameter. Today, I wouldn't want to invest, let us say, another 5,000 rupees in buying a little better efficient appliance because it is costing me more and the current code requirements do not mandate me to do so. It has certain cost implications, maybe cost savings for today, but there is a little recurring cost which is coming through. There is some interaction which it will have with the weather. There is a wear and tear. So there is a whole lot of chain of events which builds up in every decision we make with respect to the building's design as well as operation. Let us talk about two interesting factors which cause a lot of dynamics in the building's energy demand. The first and foremost is thermal comfort and preferences. You would have studied, you would be listening to comfort adaptation maybe from a couple of, you know, more experts, because now this is a very hot field for at least the last 15 years. There has been a lot of attention and attraction in this field. So you would see a lot of, you know, work being done and presented. But I'm not going to explain what is adaptation, what is comfort and stuff. But I will only tell you where it affects the energy demand. As we know, you know, there is a very nice definition of thermal comfort. Comfort is a negotiable socio-cultural construct. Construct is something which is an abstract phenomenon. You know, it's, and comfort is very closely or strongly driven by the socio-cultural attributes, and it is negotiable. See, tomorrow, Tamil Nadu government removes the subsidy on electricity. Tomorrow, they are going to tell you, we do not give you any slab. And, you know, the basic free electricity is removed for, let us say, 90% of people. Then you will really negotiate on your comfort. I mean, this is a fact. There are very few who are going to really, you know, say, no, nothing doing. I will run my air conditioner at 22 degrees and I will run it, you know, 12 hours a day. There will be some negotiation which will happen. Right. This is one example. Similarly, every aspect of comfort, every aspect of your need, as well as your, so-called luxury, is negotiable. And because of this, there is a lot of dynamics which happens in the energy demand that we really see. We undertook one interesting study. This was little time back. I had taken a few pockets for the study in Chennai. One of it is pretty, I wouldn't say outskirts, but it's not so dense. It is in, Pallavaram, not so densely populated. Couple of other locations which are in the vicinity, plus there is one more location which is very close to the seashore. I took certain people, a group of people in each of them, collected responses from them on thermal comfort. This was purely a comfort study. For Chennai, for the population that I was really looking at, it came out to be that around 29 degrees centigrade is what people call as neutrality. We know we are running our air conditioners at 24, 26 degrees, or sometimes 22 or lesser even. International standards say 24 degrees, around 24 degrees is accepted to be a comfort. But these studies come from purely your physiology and its requirement. Your core body needs to be around 37 degrees. It cannot go high, it cannot go low. To maintain that, people say the ambient has to be 24 degrees. That is a scientifically proven fact. But people can, to an extent, adapt up till 29 degrees. There is a problem here because this is, number one, subjective, because it is specific to a set of population which were responding to this. Okay, even if I say this is a representative sample, it's my own study, but still I'm telling you the shortcomings or rather challenges associated with it. There is a limitation in terms of the representativeness. Even if we say, okay, let's say it was a large sample and they have been consistently responding, it is representative. But then, how do I trust the same people, the same set of people would behave the same way 5 years from now? It is their today's requirement. And maybe 5 years, 10 years from now, maybe there are policy changes, there are environmental conscious things which are coming in, or maybe, they get used to more air-conditioned settings. So this number is going to be very flexible. One more thing that came out through the study was, though they say neutral condition is 29 degree, they always said preferred condition to be somewhere between 23 to 24. So there is like a 5 or 6 degree gap between what I prefer versus what I feel is it's okay for me. I feel 29 degree is okay for me, but I prefer to be at 23 or 24 degree. That is a desire. And this 5 degrees, you can say, the degree equivalent of desire is what is actually driving the energy consumption, for example, in a city like Chennai. Interestingly, there are variations between summer and winter. There is a significant difference between male and female groups. And more so, people working with, in an air-conditioned environment versus people who have been used to non-air-conditioned spaces. I have not placed a lot of data here for, to avoid, a very cluttered information. But we also had older age people, like say, 65 and above versus middle-aged people around 40s versus youngsters. There was a significant difference, whereas, elderly people didn't prefer anything less than 30 degrees. They were very happy at 30 degrees. Whereas if you go lower in the age, people wanted somewhere close to 20 degrees. This is something, there is a nearly 10 degree gap between the thermal expectation within the same household. So, running an air conditioner versus opening a window, the decision-making process, who finally wins the remote, who, owns the remote, determines what is your energy demand. It is, in a way, it is like that. Having talked about comfort, the last thing I would point out here, the adaptive comfort limits considerably vary from city to city. This is a profile which we built based on the studies conducted in Chennai. This is what you would have, maybe just quickly to tell you, x-axis has the months, rather it is a hourly data that I am plotting. This is the air temperature in y-axis. The gray color line you see, this is the air temperature or dry bulb temperature. This band that you see, the dotted line band, red color one you see, is the comfort band. So this is something which you would require inside your building. And the blue one, the blue color line here, represents the daily mean temperature. Interestingly, if you see in Bangalore, a lot of time, or nearly, 80% of the time all through the year, this blue line stays within these two red, the band, within this band. So, if your building is not really playing negative in terms of climate, your indoors are going to be comfortable, and consequently the energy demand will be lesser. Whereas if you look at a place like Chennai, there is a lot of, or at least partly there are excesses, and the gray line is the actual hourly temperature, which is significantly fluctuating. And if you look at Delhi, it fluctuates on both the sides. In summers, you have the higher extremes, winters, you have the lower extremes. And as I said, as climate change knocks our door, we are going to see more part of this moderate seasons, this moderate periods, going to be, moving outside the comfort band. What is currently comfortable is going to be either, skewed this side or this side. So this is going to be a critical issue rather than the extreme summers and extreme winters. The next aspect of, the differences are the diversities that we talk about comes in terms of appliance ownership and its usage pattern. Energy, we commonly refer to the power drawn by your cooling appliances, that is cooling energy. In Chennai, there is no air coolers, but if you look at the northern and central India, it comes from air coolers, air conditioners, sometimes, fans and stuff like that. Then you have the lighting energy and any other connected loads, plug loads. Interestingly, in the last, 15 years at least, we have a lot of connected loads in the building. If you remember your childhood days, if you were in a village, you would really understand there were not much devices running on electricity. Maximum two lights, that's what each household had. Incandescent lamps and sometimes a tube light. And, radios run on battery, hardly on electricity. And, we didn't have, fans were also not that common. But now if you look at the connected loads, the plug loads, every house at least has one laptop, minimum three mobile phones, plus a lot of electricity consuming devices, geysers, you name it, ovens, induction stove. So much of electricity demand or power is being drawn by each household. I would just mention that we are doing a pan India measurement of the energy demand and the power drawn by different set of buildings. We are focusing on primarily residences, but we are also looking at a few commercial establishments. We have our measurements going on in Chennai as well. We have Chennai and, six other cities across the country where we are trying to understand the overall residence level as well as appliance level energy demand. Some of my experience sharing comes from these studies only, so I wish to just acknowledge them here. This is one of the energy demand profile data which we collected from Bhopal. You would actually see the overall residences, the main supply marked in blue, and one air conditioner's energy or the power drawn marked in orange. You would actually see, the overall demand is primarily driven by or predominantly driven by the air conditioner operation. You would see the whole thing actually fluctuating, getting the peaks, getting the minima based on when the air conditioner is really operating. There are certain areas where maybe the geysers, maybe some other appliances start working together, right? So there are a few places where you have appliance loads start fluctuating. But if you look at the specific high points, it will be driven by air conditioner. And you would be interested to see these spikes here. They represent your air conditioner's compressor. Whenever your compressor is on, it takes a lot of power to start. The start-stop of compressor consumes a lot of power. So a regular conventional air conditioner draws a lot of power during that operation. If you run an inverter air conditioner, if I show you the profile of an inverter AC, these ups and downs won't be there. So nearly you will have like a smooth running, though there will be some ups and downs. It won't be a lot of spikes here. And this initial, part here is what we refer as the peak demand. And interestingly, if you have a gated community, let us say 100 residences in a community connected to a single supply, now all of them are likely to turn on their air conditioners between 8 and 8:30 in the night, or say 8 to 9 in the night, and their peak profile will match at that time. And this is where the whole system and the network gets really stressed, and power failures are very common during this period. I'm going to show you one simple interesting case here, how the energy profile is dynamic and diverse as well. This is a gated community again in Chennai. I wouldn't be naming that, but there are about 650, close to 650 houses here, which have a two-bedroomed, a three-bedroomed, and three-bedroom luxury. So like a three-and-a-half-bedroomed apartment. It's like a 14-story structure. We did a survey with people on what set temperatures they usually operate their air conditioner. You would see the mean temperature they set is around 24 degrees, whereas it ranges somewhere from 18 to 28 degrees. There is a diversity. Now, number two, the hours of operation, you would see the mean number of hours is close to 6.5 hours, whereas the standard deviation is pretty high. You would see somewhere from 3 to more than 15 hours the air conditioners were being operated within the same gated community. Look at the efficiency of air conditioner. You had people, around 10% of them, who were owning air conditioners which were very low on rating. Plus, we also had a considerable number of people, percentage of people who had a very good 5-star rated, or rather energy efficient air conditioner. Now you would start to understand energy demand or energy or the power drawn is a factor of the set point temperature, the hours of operation, and the appliance I own. Now here itself you get the permutation combinations ready. If I have, let us say, three conditions in each of them, you start getting three power, so the number of choices or the diversity becomes so probabilistic in nature. And this is the way that we are approaching the problem, where we are starting to understand the range of possible energy demands rather than a single deterministic value. Now, when we looked at this, residence and its power consumption and its energy demand, it was a little interesting. You would see there are three types. I have marked it with different colors, blue, green, and red. Type 1 is a two-bedroomed unit, and 2 represents the 3-bedroomed, and type 3 is the 3.5. This is 2, this is 3, and 3.5 BHK unit. So this is what the building is. But if you look at their annual energy consumption in units, you would actually see the distribution is quite wide. This is the blue one is for the 2-bedroomed unit, whereas if you look at this portion, the one that I am hatching in the slide. This portion, if you see there, this portion actually, the houses located here are actually consuming higher than both the 3-bedroomed and 3.5-bedroomed residences, the people living there. Right? There is a lot of overlap, that is, a smaller house consuming nearly double the amount of power than a 3 or 3.5-bedroomed unit. There is nothing hierarchical that, a large house has to consume more. But I'm saying the EPI or the energy performance index would sometimes be very limited, or it would have its limitations when we talk about the actual power drawn and the type of people living there. Because we are normalizing it, it will lead to certain limitations there. Though, currently we are adapting and we are practicing EPI as a norm in residential building, it has its own challenges. We also find that the power or the energy consumption here, we are talking about the monthly energy consumption here in y-axis, And in x-axis, you would see the temperature, the monthly mean temperature. This is very closely correlated. That is, as the monthly temperature increases, mean temperature increases from winter to summer, we progress. There is a gradual increase, or there is at least a logarithmic profile that is being followed, that the residences start to consume more. This is a very well-known fact that type 1, type 2, type 3, there is a clear categorization. But what more interestingly we find, this is the block diagram of these buildings. What we really find is there is a good impact on the way the buildings are oriented, the kind of solar exposure the buildings are getting. Say, we found a significant difference between the top story residences versus the residences in the lower stories. We found significant differences between, residences facing the north and east-west orientation versus the ones which are facing south, east and west. As you would know, Chennai, 13.1 degree north latitude. So during summers, you would have sun from your northern side of your building. So north, east and west becomes critical orientations. So if your residence is located facing north, north and west especially, your energy demand is likely to be pretty higher. And this is what we have tried to show. This is what I have tried to show in this graph. This is north, east and south. N, E and S represents the orientations in which the building is facing. So there is a very strong dependence on the kind of exposure the building is having, the way the building is designed, and this brings a lot of design intervention which are critically required. I always say buildings are today mostly engineered and modularized than being climate responsive. I'm not saying build a hut and build it climate responsive everywhere. Today is the age of precast and modular housing. I do a lot of work in that field. I appreciate that technology by itself. But there is a lot of thought process which is essential in order to make the real impact on buildings' energy demand profile. Otherwise, the buildings are, which are going to last for, let us say, 50 or 60 years with its service life, we are actually building more problems than solution. On one hand, we are meeting the demand supply through more engineered solutions. We are creating more problems in terms of energy and energy demand that would otherwise be. See, we have to live with it for 50 years. There is no other go. An apartment that you buy, at least for 40 years, you would want to run without major retrofit or even, forget about demolishing it. So with that, it's like a lifelong thing that you are looking for. The last thing that I would also mention, there is a lot of localized factors which affect. I was talking to you about the height at which the buildings are located, the orientation the buildings are having. Whereas there are certain unsaid things that you can't really model, you cannot really simulate them in your tools, you can't do calculation. Interestingly, the buildings which were inward facing, these buildings, these residential units, especially in the lower floors, up to 4 or 5 stories, were consuming higher amount of electricity. For a few days when we looked at the data, we couldn't really figure out, because there was no scientific reason as to why these houses alone in these, first 4 or 5 stories would consume, and all of them were consuming nearly an equal amount of energy, and they were much higher compared to the upper floors, as well as even, they were comparable with very severe solar exposed orientations. Ultimately, you have a swimming pool located right here in the center, and there is no privacy. Though you have balconies, though you have windows that you can operate, people were not willing to sit in the balcony. People were not wanting to open their windows because they are losing privacy. There is a nice park and a swimming pool. Architecturally, the site planning looks wonderful. It's good. People prefer it. People, even I would want to have a place there to stay there. But when it comes to energy, it has a slightly different implication. So there is a little more thought process which is needed when we place things inside a site. In one of our recent study, we found that there is nearly one third prediction uncertainty in the cooling energy demand. And this is true for the mean demand, and the prediction uncertainty for peak cooling demand is around 20%. So this actually highlights that today I may project that my building can be 30% or 40% more energy efficient. So I may prove for a standard saying that I have achieved 20% energy efficiency compared to a baseline building. So I'm really happy. The agency is happy, so we close it there. But unfortunately, the uncertainty itself is 1/3, which ultimately builds up to nearly no energy efficiency that we may actually be claiming. And much of it is driven by the AC set point, which people have sensitivity to use of natural ventilation, whether you are motivated enough to open your windows, whether, you know, in a city like Delhi, you have natural provision for natural ventilation, but pollution drives the show. You know, noise pollution, air pollution, people wouldn't want to just open the window and get ventilated because they know that the air is not good. So they end up running air conditioners. Then the number of hours for which the building is operated or the air conditioner or the systems are operated. And please remember, this is not purely occupant driven alone. I think as a designer, as engineers, we are not supposed to put the total blame on the occupant. We can't say, you know, it is the person who's switching on the air conditioner, it is his mistake. It is the responsibility of the designer to provide enough opportunities for them. So as if willing, there is definitely a potential for energy demand reduction. So this is something I also wish to highlight from this study. Just to show you quickly, I'm not going to talk much about it. This is the energy demand profile for Roorkee, a couple of buildings in Roorkee. I just brought this here because as from a, you know, student's perspective, if you looked at Chennai, the monthly mean temperature versus the energy was, you know, going like this way. It was, you know, straight and it was linear. It was starting from this and moving on like this. Whereas in Roorkee, you will see a inverted bell shape or a U-shaped curve. This portion represents winter and this portion represents summer. So here we have a moderate period for which the, you know, energy demand is pretty less. And this is where I said there is an alarming increase because the moderate season is diminishing eventually, ending up with, you know, the energy demand not looking as a U shape, but rather it is becoming more flatter and flatter. So I will skip some of these things considering the time. The last thing I would talk about maybe for the couple of, you know, maybe for a couple of more minutes is the national benchmark versus the local context. I showed you this image in the beginning of the presentation. So we have 5 zones. We have the EPA limits and the star rating, you know, categories which are available to us. But what we did was something very interesting. We considered a simple residential unit, a 2-bedroom residential unit. This is an approved layout for the central government's, you know, mass housing programs. This is one of the approved schemes. You know, it's nicely ventilated, lighting is good, the building is, you know, nicely made up. So what we did was we considered this building. Let us assume I'm giving you one of the cases that we looked at. I'm going to talk about the medium thermal mass case. I'm not detailing it out too much, but let us say you had a brick masonry structure. Let us say this building is made up of brick and mortar, RC frame construction with brick masonry. Now, let us assume this building is going to be placed all across the country. So what we did was we created a 50 kilometer by 50 kilometer grid all through the country. And we placed this building at every 50 kilometer distance. And then we tried to predict what is the performance of this building all through the country. So what you really see here is the cooling degree hours and this is the heating degree hours. They simply represent how much degrees on an average the residents or this building stays above or below the thermal neutral condition. So when the temperature is above thermal neutrality, you will need cooling. It is below, then you need heating. And this map tells you the energy performance index, the EPA that you talked about in your star rating system. If I construct the same building all across the country, the EPA is going to be significantly different. Let us forget all across the country. Let us just take two locations. Let us say I will take Chennai or near Chennai, a location somewhere here, and I will take another location somewhere in the west coast, right? Both climate zones are same. Both are warm and humid regions. So the EPA benchmarks are the same. Let us assume that I need a 3-star rating. What I would do is I would try and maintain the EPA to be between 21 and 24. Let us say I am achieving an EPA of 24, so I gain 3-star rating. 24, if you look at this, this average residence is actually consuming around 90 at this point, and this residence is consuming about 40 units in this location. So what kind of energy efficiency intervention that you will do, how much you will invest to achieve this 3-star rating in Chennai will be significantly different from that of a West Coast location, maybe Mangalore, maybe Kochi, or maybe Mumbai. The investment versus return versus how much you really spend to achieve that much amount of energy saving is drastically different. So in order to nearly solve this problem, we have come up with a new climate zone. This is just completed work. We have, you know, started the stakeholder consultation. Instead of a simple, you know, 5-zone that we are looking at, we studied the climate profiles for the last 30 years. And then we have also looked at the future climate scenarios. We have looked at, we have worked with, you know, different agencies for this purpose. And ultimately, we have kind of narrowed down to a 15-zone climate classification where we find a better representation of India's quite diverse climatic conditions. And this is purpose built for building energy and energy demand related applications. So we are not going to totally solve the diversity issues, but at least we can narrow it down. Rather, if you look at, you know, a location in this place versus a location here would be coming under different zones. So the benchmarks could be different and the regulation of energy efficiency could be more sensible. I think we are nearly there with time. So maybe just one last thing that I would mention. As a part of another large, you know, research consortia, we are in the process of developing localized weather data for every 25 kilometer radius across the country. If you look at, let us say, a city like Chennai, you have weather data, you can download, you can calculate things, you can run simulations. But let us say you are moving about, you know, 100 kilometers away from Chennai, you wouldn't have a weather station, no standard weather data is available. Similar is the case with any location. You know, today, trust me, we are looking at places which are around 200 to 50 kilometers apart, but we are using one of the station's information for simulating and proving that the buildings are energy efficient. So through this work, we are contributing towards a 25 kilometer grid at which we are trying to make sure this building performance assessment suited weather data is made available. So I would just stop it here. Any questions, any points, I'm happy to discuss. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. That was a wonderful session. Participants, you may please ask your questions if you have any.
Sir, I have one question. Where is this research conducted? Means, is there any specific name of the institution where this energy consumption and all these data which you have shown, where it is prepared in India?
There is no single institution or agency which is doing it. Say, for example, we are looking at energy demand in a couple of projects that we are looking at. You know, projects, when I say, these are little larger, like, you know, 4-5 year long research projects supported by government, where we are tying up with different institutions. We have partner institutes in Chennai, we have partner institutes in Kolkata, Ahmedabad, etc. So with which we will, you know, collectively look at data. So we have certain repositories. We would eventually make them public access.
Okay.
Similarly, at least five or six different groups are pursuing this interest. So different
Okay.
levels are different grains of data is being collected. I would also like to add, eventually we are working with Government of India to host a centralized repository where all this information can be standardized and presented. Today we do
Yes,
not
yes.
have a central platform, but in the
Yes.
next couple of years we would be developing and launching it. We are starting with the pilot work right now, but eventually this is what is an initiative that Government of India has taken.
Okay, yes, that only I wanted to ask. So, sir, for constructing locally, since sir, I am in Maharashtra in Pune district, so can I get access to this data? From where will I get access? Means you have shown very beautifully it is, and very correct, in a correct manner you have shown energy consumption graphs, etc.
If you would want to conduct some study, let us say you want to do some measurements, I'll be happy to help. Generally I'm making it as a note because these are government supported initiatives. So if there are specific focus studies that in a group or something that you would want to undertake, I'll be happy to help. That is not an issue. As far data is concerned, currently set of data we are hosting it online in our website, but not all data is currently available because we are still, cleaning up the data. There is a lot of noise in the data, which takes, some amount of time. We are doing it through IoT-based collection system. So data comes, but, we also would like to make sure there are not critical errors in the data. So that process is happening. It would
Okay,
take at
okay.
least, another year for, this complete set to be in the public domain.
Okay, sir. And can I get the slideshow of this webinar?
You have anyway the recording. I wouldn't really be happy, with the slides because anyway, if it is essential, I can share. There's no secrecy about it. Anyway, the
No,
session is
no.
being recorded.
Yes, sir. No problem, sir. Thank you. We have another session, no, sir, after this at 12 p.m.
Yes. Any more questions to sir, participants?
In general, I would, also like to encourage each one of you as engineering graduates, don't confine yourself to, my scope of working is to look at the civil structures, construction, planning, management of the building alone. You
Yes, sir.
know, today any field is very diverse. Energy is no longer an electrical subject. It's
Yes,
becoming
sir.
a day-to-day thing. You cannot build anything without paying attention to energy demand. So the mandates are now more universal than targeting to a particular audience. So I think each one of us will be responsible looking at a team of people developing some construction project. There is a
Yes, sir.
contribution from each of us towards energy efficiency. So
Yes,
that
sir.
is
Yes.
something I wish to really state here.
Yes, sir. Correct.
Okay, thank you, sir. So, if there are no more questions, I request Ms. Harshvardhini to propose a vote of thanks.
Warm greetings to the respected guest speaker of the session, respected HOD, faculties of civil and other department of SVCE, and my dear friends. This is Harshavartani from third year civil engineering. It is an honor and privilege to extend the oath of thanks on this special occasion. On behalf of the Department of Civil Engineering, I would like to thank our guest speaker, Dr. Rajasekhar Ilongovan sir, who spared time from his busy schedule to deliver the lecture. Sir, indeed your lecture was very informative and thought-provoking. Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable knowledge on energy demand reduction in residences. We hope to have the opportunity to learn from you in the future. And I would like to thank our HOD, Dr. Kumuda ma'am, for her constant support and guidance. I would like to express our gratitude to Mr. Arun sir and Mrs. Ruby Priya ma'am for coordinating and organizing this wonderful webinar. I thank all the faculties, students from SVCE and other institutions for the active participation in this webinar and making it a big success. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, very much.
Thank you, and best wishes to each one of you.
Yes, sir.
It was nice being here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll take you. Thank you.